Daniel chapter 6. We left off last week on we left off on verse 9, but I really wanted to read this to you in Daniel, and we'll go 6 verse 10. Now when Daniel knew, now you know what, come on, turn around. You got a word in your heart? Go sit down. He keeps telling me he's not going to be a preacher. He keeps saying, well, I'm going to be an ESPN sports analyst, which is probably a better financial decision if you really want to make some money, but I'm prophesying you're going to be a preacher. Amen. Well, he could be like me, a model. Anyway. All right, let's just stay sanctified, church. Amen. All right, here we go. So Daniel, we read in Daniel chapter 6 earlier that there was a plot against Daniel because of Daniel's faith. We're going to pick it up in verse 10, and I'm going to draw a parallel out of that for us today where we are. Let's pick it up. Now, when Daniel knew that the writing was signed, he went home, and in the upper room with his windows open toward Jerusalem, he knelt down on his knees three times that day and prayed and gave thanks before his God, as was his custom early in those days. Then these men assembled and found Daniel praying and making supplication before his God. Can I say something to you? You are supposed to be being caught doing what God has told you to do. Does that make sense to anybody? But pastor, what about if I get in trouble? There is no promise that you don't get in trouble serving God. Look, I know this is the North American church, and I know we've been programmed to such this and that and the third, but there is no, can I say something to you that's going to really mess you up? Christianity is not even supposed to be safe. Pastor, can I come to your church? Is it safe there? Read the Bible, man. Following God is dangerous. And this is a North American church because, man, I was just talking to my friend Johannes on the way back. And you know what's happening? There are actual genocides where people are showing up with machine guns and saying, denounce Christ or die. No, I'm not denouncing. And they're being killed. But that doesn't happen here because we've been so watered down. And there's no reason for persecution to happen because the church isn't doing anything worth being persecuted. I saw this movie called Infidel. Has anybody seen it? Yeah. On my movie Beast? Franco, I know you've seen this one. You got to get your game up, cuz. And what happened in this movie is this journalist, it's based on a true story, he's a born-again believer. He goes over into to Iran, I believe, or I think he's in Iran, and begins to preach Jesus. And they kidnap him, and they take him into prison and say, you're going to get up on national TV, you're going to denounce Jesus, and tell everybody that you serve Allah or something like that. He says, no. Well, we're going to pronounce, they pronounce him to death. So they put him in front of the fire squad. They say, I'm going to give you one more chance to deny Jesus. And if you denounce Jesus, we'll have mercy on you, and we'll let you do 10 years in prison or something like that. And they took the guns out. They blindfolded and they said, denounce Christ. He said, no. They took the guns, denounced Christ. He said, no. And they put blanks in it and started firing at him. He wouldn't denounce Jesus. He wound up getting broken out. It's based on a true story. I'm sorry, man. That is a spoiler alert, right? Did you hear the story? Did you hear the story in the Middle East where the church was packed and the man ran in with a gun and yelled at everybody, denounce Jesus or die? And half the church ran out. The other half said, we're not denouncing. He took his mask off. He said, I'm the new pastor in town. I just wanted to make sure you guys were for real. Because that's who you know you can worship with, those cats. You can worship with those cats. But there's a great separation. Listen, you got to hear me right now prophetically. This is Daniel chapter 7 is so, there's such a parallel happening in our time today. The government says, yo, you're going to stop church and you're not going to sing and you're not going to chant and you can only have this many people in church and you're going to do what we say because you're a super spreader. Don't worry about the liquor store. They can stay open. And don't worry about the weed dispensary. They can stay open. And don't worry about that. They can stay open. But I was just in shop right the other day. There was 400 people in there. Don't you come to church because you're going to, don't you come to church. You're the super spreader of this virus. And you know what Daniel did? Daniel went home and Daniel worshiped and Daniel opened his door. Daniel didn't go hide in secret. Let's go hide. Let's just stay home and we can be Christians at home. Of course you can be a Christian at home. Go ahead, be a Christian at home. But there's something together. What is the reason? What is the conspiracy to keep us from each other and to keep us from having church? Because there's something powerful when God's... Wait. If we're a body... Come here, Alfred, stand up. Come here, Gabriel. Come here. Stand over here. Come here, Joel. Come on. Let's go. Now, if we're a body... And we have a, all right, you come over here. You'll be one of his arms. Stand right here. You'll be an arm. Come here. You're a leg. Hey, stay right there. Come here, Tony. You're down here. Let me see. Come here. Sean. Come on, Sean. Hurry up. Hustle. Let's go. All right. So stand up real quick. So these are your arms. Come here. These are your legs. Now, come on, guys. Come out this way a little bit. He's got longer legs than that. Come over here. Stand over here. All right. See, all right. Now, when you have a body, what is that ringing? I think, you know, when something bothers me, it just starts bothering me, and I got to, like, just start preaching so I don't think about it. Anyway, so if this is a body, and God called us a body, and we come together, because Paul said, he said, what good is it if the leg says, I'm no good, I want to be like the arm, but then the point is we'd be a body that is disjointed or out of place or dismembered. And if the body is the body when it comes together and Christ being the head of the body, when we come together as, all of a sudden I get like this visual Voltron. Anybody from the 80s can just holler at me for a moment. They don't know what they're missing nowadays. What we used to say, something unite. What was it? Autobots, unite. Look at you. Look at you, Will, just being old over here. Come on, right? Is that the right one? Is that it? Autobots, unite? Was that it? Transformers, all right. Transformers, more than meets the eyes. Oh, there it is, 80s, 90s. But anyway, there it is, Voltron Assemble. I remember the coolest thing you could get as a kid was that big old metal Voltron with the different parts. And you could put those five parts together, and it was like $150. But once you got that thing together, you had the coolest toy around. I was trying to talk to my son about this stuff. I was like, don't this stuff interest you? He was like, no. I said, what about like a metal Hess truck? Anybody get a metal Hess truck for Christmas? They're plastic now. Meanwhile, I said, what do you want for Christmas? Can I get a new video game for my DS, Dad? That's what they don't understand, what it was like. But you get these body parts together, and when a body is together, it can accomplish more than when the body is apart. But if I can convince you that you're a good Christian over there, and I convince you that you're a good Christian over there, and I convinced you that you're a good Christian over there, and you're a good Christian over there, I'm convinced you. Don't worry about it. You can be at home, and you'll be fine just as you are as an arm, and you're a leg, and you'll be okay over there, and you'll be a body, and you'll be okay over there, and you're an arm, and you're a leg. Don't worry about it. You're still a part of the body. You're just disjointed. But how can we be, if the church is not so non-essential and it's not like it's supposed to be, why did the Lord spend almost entire chapters of the Bible talking about the formation and the gathering of the church? He said, in fact, when you guys get together, make sure you keep even the gifts of the Spirit in order, because if one gives an interpretation, make sure there's no more than two messages and one interpretation or one prophetic utterance or this and that. And if you come together, make sure, in fact, God was so concerned about the church, he comes in and Paul says, hey, listen, I've heard there's things that are happening in this church that aren't even mentioned in the Gentile world. But if it was so important that they stayed home, why did he say, do not forsake the assembling of the brethren? Like, what did he say? What's the second part of that say? Like some do. Because what happens is, when you are out of line, when we are out of line, I mean, you say we have a brother or sister in the house with us, because remember church mothers and church fathers, when a church mother could pull a lady aside and say, hey, yo, there's some things that put something in your, right? What does the Bible say? It says, you ladies teach what? What's the Bible say? Come on, talk to me. It says you teach the younger generation, right? Because what happens, we can be home, we can fake the funk at home, and we can get away with stuff at home, and we can put our face up and get on a Zoom meeting and smile, but there's something when we get together that what happens is when the body gets together, all of a sudden God's glory can be poured out in such a way, no wonder they want us home. No wonder they want us separated. No wonder. And this is not a political message, because I'm not political, believe me. But I can promise you that if we get to this place where we are all of a sudden say, okay, whatever you say, Mr. Governor, whatever you say, Mr. President, whatever you say for me to do, I will do. We have then just declared, I don't worship God anymore. I worship what the government says because it's safe. You got to hear me. It's safe. I'm protected here. I'm safe here. I'm protected if I listen to what the government says. And I said this. This is my conviction. Here it is. Ready? Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Work it out. Work out your own. Get a conviction from God. My job as the senior leader of this house is to hear from God. Find the word. Bible says, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that right is divide the truth, not being ashamed. All right. Oh, you missed me up. Hold on. Stop talking when I'm talking. Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman who needeth not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Okay, now you can talk. Okay, all right. And my job is to take that and now declare this to what I believe. Now, there are some non-essentials in the ministry, in church. Jesus Christ is the only way to heaven. Non-essential, you can't argue it. There's no arguing it. His blood is the only way to get to heaven. Come on. We're born sinners, and without an encounter with him, we don't go to heaven. That is non-negotiable. Some prophetic stuff, negotiable. My job as the pastor is to take this word, declare it, speak it, and what your job is to do is don't even believe what I say. Get your Bible, get it home, open your Bible, read your Bible, get a witness in your spirit. In fact, get so spiritual that you come with a revelation for the body. Oh, you got to hear me today. Because it's not just the pastor that's supposed to have a revelation. You're supposed to be so deep in your word that when there is some prophet that gets up and speaks something good, we say, amen, I found that in the Bible. But when someone gets up and starts saying some stuff that's out of pocket, you got something in here that ain't right. And you got my permission. Somebody gets up here and prophesies, get up and rebuke them. You don't need, pastor, can I rebuke them? You should already be doing it. But if you're not together, how are you going to do that? The Bible said that Daniel knew that they had a plot against him. And he went home, opened the doors, got on his knees, and prayed. Why? Because that's what he was supposed to do. Well, pastor, I don't know if it's safe. I'm not promising you this church is safe. Get me on camera right now. This is my COVID-19 release statement. I don't promise anybody their safety. I can't save you. I can't protect you. I'm going to worship. You come worship with me. I'm not promising. I will disinfect this place. I will take temperatures. I will do everything I can do, but I can't save you. And I can't keep you from God. I can't keep you alive, and I can't. The Bible said it is appointed for once man to die, and then the judgment. This is the revelation you got to get. You are born with an appointment on your life. Exactly. An appointment on your life. Yeah. Dude. I'm sorry, I'm getting out of control right now. When the anointing gets on I feel like, man, I wish there was like a giant here I could just like take his head off right now. But why is it we were so easily taking our life with no regard when we didn't serve God? Be out there just sinning, clubbing, drinking and driving, putting needles in your arm with dope in it, going to the dope man, hiding drugs from the cops. Hold on, there's some blue-collar criminals. You wasn't paying your taxes. Come on, all right? Make sure I get everybody in this thing. Playing with Ouija boards and all kind of things and didn't care one thing about your life. In fact, today I was watching something. They were like, well, you know what? Just make sure you do your social distance. Keep your clean. But the one, can we be with our significant other? Oh, yeah, you can do that. Just go ahead and you can keep sinning like that, but make sure you keep apart from each other. Anybody else you keep apart from, but just go ahead and keep sinning. We didn't care nothing about our lives when we was out there sinning. Now all of a sudden we got saved and we're like, okay, wait a minute. Someone said, read the Bible. The Bible says in Matthew that there'll be plagues, there'll be diseases, there'll be all kind of things that happen to us. So what are you going to do? Go shut yourself up in the house and stay there because it's safe at home. It's safe there. I've heard of people that never even left their house that got it.
Yeah, it's true.
It's true. Yeah. But here's what I'm saying. This is my conviction. This is where I am with God. If this is this crazy and is that there's this much turmoil, if I'm going out, I'm going out guns blazing. I'm prophesying. I'm preaching. I'm plowing. I'm declaring God. I'm jumping in a car with some teenagers and going to a place where there's 5,000 kids. And we're this. I looked around. I said to my wife, I said to Mary, I said, because your mind, you get so twisted when you're like just hear this stuff all day. You got to like deprogram yourself. And this fear just comes. I said, I rebuke that in Jesus' name. I said, we're worshiping in this house. And I said, Lord, if you're not God enough to keep us from getting this, I said, that's how I talked to the Lord. I said, then you don't even deserve praise because we've come here to serve you and we've come to worship you. And you felt this peace as these people were worshiping. What I'm saying is this. It's probably going to get worse. It's probably going to get crazier. There's probably going to be more diseases and more plagues that come out. What are you going to do? You gonna lock yourself in the house? Pastors are getting arrested right now. Still, pastors are getting arrested. Orthodox Jewish people are getting arrested. You don't hear nothing about, all you hear is about Jewish leaders and Christian leaders being arrested. You don't hear nothing about Hindus being arrested. You don't hear about Muslims being arrested. I don't hate anybody. I love them all. I hope everybody receives Jesus. But there's a hate for Christianity and there's a hate for Jews. Because why? Because the presence of God rests on us and who we represent. You can get up today, and you guys can go be seated. You could get up today and tell somebody, bless God. Or you could say, oh, I worship trees, and I drink cat's blood, and I don't go by any gender pronoun. Let's give this person a Nobel Peace Prize. Person of the year. Man of the year. It's a woman. Man of the year. That's a woman. I'm in rare form today, so just go with me. Woman of the year. No, that's a man. You see these bathrooms? Men's and women's. Listen to me. Gender specific. No men are going into women's bathroom. No, I've instructed my men's home group. I tell them, don't ever be violent. If you see a woman, you see a man going at a woman, you have my permission to backslide and drag them out of the church. We're living in crazy times. Look, they just passed. I was watching the news. They said they just passed something in the new bill that says, you saw it, right? You cannot call, we're removing the word him, her, mother, father. What are we? We're blah. I would like to introduce you to it. This is it, all right? This is my cousin it. This is my other cousin. This is they. What the heck is going on? Yo, listen to me. The debased mind. You know, when God is pulled out of anything, you know what happens when God is pulled out of anything? The further we fall from him. Right? And listen, I'm telling you, if you have never been on a mission trip, 2021, we're going on mission trips. Because I'm going to tell you why. Get your passport going because it takes 90 days. I just got mine back the other day. I put it in 90 days ago, just got it back. You will change the revelation of your life and how you see God and see church will change once you leave America. Amen. All right, you'll be in Cuba. You'll be in Cuba, dirt floors. Dirt floors, no bathrooms. In fact, the bathrooms don't even have toilet seats in them. No toilet paper. And you little kids run around barefoot. It was a rainstorm one time. It was just pouring down rain. And they had some tarps. And I'm talking about this place was packed. And there were people outside under the trees worshiping. And I was like, Pastor, is this? He goes, they have nothing else but God. That's all they have is God. And all of a sudden, the worship starts, and you feel like you're in this praise service that you've never been in before. And I'm thinking, my people back home in America, let it rain too hard, and we won't go to church. Right? Well, Pastor, I was going to come to church, but you know what? There was a half inch of snow. And you knew, we're the worst here. Let there be a quarter inch of snow prophesied. Let it be forecasted for New Jersey. I'm talking about people don't drive. They clear off everything. We are so programmed to take a little bit of God and fit it into our life, and we expect, watch this, to reap the benefit of serving this great God when God gives this little tiny piece of our life. Here's my new rule. Not my new rule. I wish it was happened. You can't be a member of a church. You can't vote in an election until you've left America and went into a place. I'm talking about, I will be preaching in Cuba. Chickens will be running through the middle of the church service. Dogs. I'm talking about dogs. Dogs are trying to get saved. Just sitting in the church service. And here's the craziest one. They put all these kids. You think? They had all these kids in a row. And the ushers, I'm about to bring this back. The ushers had these long sticks. And he had a flip-flop on the end. That's called a super chanclata right there, right? The kids were getting out of control, and the usher was like, bang! I said, if they did that in America, oh, my God, could you imagine? You know the problem is? Our kids need to get a little chanclata on their butts. That was when I saw that, yo, that little kid was out of place. That usher was like, bang. That little kid was like. Yo, where's Elvis at? Elvis, next week I want you to get some sticks with some flip-flops on them. Don't worry about the kids. It's the adults we need to get in line first. Come on, somebody. Oh, Jesus. So here we are, we find Daniel in a conundrum, a spiritual conundrum, when he is told you can't worship, but he has realized there's something inside of him that forbids him from not worshiping. Ready? You got to get this. There's something that should be inside of you that we are submissive to our governing authorities, which the Bible says, until I'm told how to worship. Verse 11, then these men assembled and found Daniel praying and making supplication before his God. Verse 12. And they went before the king and spoke concerning the king's decree. Have you signed a decree that every man who petitions any god or man within 30 days except you, O king, shall be cast into the den of lions? The king answered and said, the thing is true according to the law of the Medes and Persians, which does not alter. So they answered and said before the king that Daniel, who is one of the captives from Judah, does not show due regard for you, O king, or for the decree that you have signed, but makes his petition three times a day. Not only was Daniel defiant that he went home and prayed, he opened the windows and prayed three times a day. In other words, he said, hey, listen, have I got your attention yet? Have I got your attention? Well, guess what? And 1 o'clock, 4 o'clock, and 7 o'clock, I will be doing what I've always done, and I'll be in my house praying because my God is greater than your anti-God decree. Pastor, that's rebellious. Rebellious against man, yeah. What did Peter say when the high priest said, "I strictly warned you not to preach this Jesus, and there will be grave consequences if you preach this Jesus"? And Peter looked at him and said, "Well, who should I obey, you or God?" And they beat him again and threw him in prison again. I believe that the North American church is going to have a revelation of waking up. Because here's, ready, I'm prophesying. This is what's going to happen. There's going to be conforming. They're going to threaten us with taking away our 501c3. That's going to be the first thing they take away. "We're going to take away your 501c3 if you preach Jesus." Well, take it. I've been preaching Jesus before I had a tax-exempt card for our ministry, and I'll preach Jesus after we have one. And that only happens in America. I remember I was talking to Johannes. I was like, "Johannes," he's my friend in Sweden. I said, "How's the tax exempt?" He goes, "There's no tax exempt here in Europe. The church pays taxes." I said, "Are you serious?" He goes, every bit of money we bring in, we got to write the government a check to take up an offering in Europe. So what happens is there's going to be that. Next, there's going to be these thoughts of, hey, if you do this, there's going to be certain things that happen to you. You're going to lose certain privileges. Could it be there's a decree that's going to eventually go out in America that if we do not conform with political rules, that we will lose certain freedoms that we have? Here's the cool thing about talking, right, about living for God and serving Him, and you can be blessed and still go through a trial. All hell can break loose, and you can still shine. The rain will fall on the just and the unjust. Let me tell you, count it all joy, brother. Count it all joy. Pastor, I'm going through. Count it all joy. Count it all joy. I'm about to teach you something that's going to mess with your theology. Actually, put those two scriptures I just gave you, Caesar, up there. Acts 1:8, and then those two scriptures in Revelation. Somebody read that real loud for me. Hold on, try this again. Everybody read that loudly. Go ahead. But you say, watch this, say me, or say I. You know, this is Millville, we just say what we want, all right? Say this, I shall receive power. Not the pastor. I shall receive power. When, what? When who comes upon you? If you have not been filled with the Holy Ghost. All right, do you remember before you got saved when you were carnal? Where's Ray? He said yes. Ray was telling me stories. Because I was serving in the youth group, and I was coming home, and my wife would be in the room, and I'd be in the garage smoking a joint. And my wife would be, how are you going to be out here serving God smoking joints? I love Ray. He tells me all the stories, Colleen. And you know what I said to Ray? I said, good, I want you close to me. You're the kind of guys I want to walk with. Guys that have got, don't try to act too righteous and too holy and too fake. There's a couple churches, if you're looking for that position, they have fillings. Go find it over there. But I want to walk with some people that got a couple scars. Come on. I got a couple wounds. I've been beat down, but I'm still alive. You're the real deal. Pastor, I backslid 2 weeks ago. Praise God. Jump in the water with us. We're going to serve God together. Come on, somebody. Amen. And before you met Jesus, you had this radical encounter with God, and your life changed. It should anyway. Okay, ready? Here's a freebie. If your life has not changed, you are not born again. I'll try it over here. I was learning how they was teaching me the salsa this week. I'm not going to do it because I'll embarrass myself. All right. I'm doing the most. You cannot encounter the God that I've encountered and stay the same.